Welcome to Season 2 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement, and a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to the public health news of the day through informative interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, Stephanie Desmon talks to Dr. Anna Rule, a ventilation expert at the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. They discuss how indoor ventilation systems might help prevent the spread of COVID-19 and also how they might make things worse. Let's listen.
Anna Rule, thank you so much for joining me.
You're welcome. Thank you for inviting me.
So today we're going to talk about ventilation. I know you're an expert in that. We're hearing a lot more in recent weeks about how the virus can be spread by ventilation systems. So could you talk to me a little bit about what the risks are?
So first, I would like to start by saying that in general, like even before COVID, we use ventilation systems to reduce the risk of exposures to any risk, to any, you know, harm that is in the air. So we should see ventilation systems as our friends in this, you know, quest to control or to help with the virus. Having said that, the ventilation system should be well maintained and should be working as expected. Filters should be in place, the best filters that are available. Not all ventilation systems are able to move air through really high efficiency filters, but most ventilation systems can handle relatively high filters, high efficiency filters that are able to control the virus. So in general, ventilation systems are used to minimize the risk in indoor environments. They should not increase the risk.
So should we be trying to improve the filters that we use in buildings?
So I have been saying this also from the beginning. This is typically not something that, you know, you and I in our homes do. I mean, in your home, of course, you can buy a better filter and try to improve the ventilation in your home. But in buildings, we need to contact the experts. And so the maintenance facilities, janitorial staff know the ventilation systems. They are the ones that you should be relying on. So for a couple of months already, we have been seeing this whole movement, or I guess to say in some way, this whole emphasis on ventilation. And the building facilities people have been for a couple of months already improving their systems, checking that everything is working, increasing the airflow, because that also helps, you know, bringing more clean air, filter the air, or bring it from outside. So if you're really worried about the air in your building, make sure you contact your facilities person or your janitorial person or the manager. Ask the manager to contact that person because there's very little that you're going to be able to do personally.
We all know that the virus spreads more indoors than outdoors. Why is that?
Well, it's a relatively simple question of concentration. The more concentrated, you know, you can imagine like a plume when somebody, so for example, somebody smoking, when you exhale the cigarette smoke, immediately you see this plume. And the more air circulation and airflow in a space, then the easier that plume is going to dissipate and just dilute the particles. The same exact thing happens. It's all aerosols work the same. And so there's a couple of things that happen indoors. First of all, you may have a higher concentration of people indoors. And so if you have two or three people that may be infected, may be generating these particles that are carrying viruses, then if you have low ventilation or low airflow, those particles or those concentrations just accumulate. So that's one of the reasons that indoors is higher risk. You increase the concentration because you increase the amount of people, and if you have low ventilation. But if you increase the ventilation and reduce the number of people, which is what we have been trying to do, right, with stay at home and minimize your trips outside or to other places, then that improves the, reduces the risk of increasing the concentration and improves the chances of not being infected.
So I'm wondering, early on we heard that in China, an air conditioning system may have spread the virus. So I guess my question is, does air conditioning help or does it hurt?
So this particular case, it was very interesting, and I read it with interest because I was getting some questions. This case that was published about the ventilation system, it was a case of a really, really badly designed ventilation system. If you read the paper, it was a relatively big restaurant. It had the fan on one end, pushing air towards the building. And then on that same fan, on that same ventilation unit, was the return air. So the air was just being kind of like shot for a little bit and then brought back in. And that's not how you are supposed to design a ventilation system. You're supposed to have the exhaust on one end and the inlet on one other, on another end. The air was not being filtered. It was just recirculated without any really filtering. And there was, you know, high density. There were, I think there's like three or four of the tables side by side, all of them were occupied. And so this is a good, very good case of what not to do. But in general, ventilation systems are supposed to help, not hurt.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Does it matter sort of, I guess, as we head toward the end of summer and then the beginning of when you might use heat? So what's the difference between air conditioning and heat, and how might one help or, you know, which one's better, I guess, for ventilation in this situation?
Well, in ventilation systems, really, there's a couple of very, very simple parts, right? The fan, or the motor that moves the air, the filter that traps whatever, you know, contaminants before the air is introduced into the place, and a heating or cooling depending on the season. So it's typically the same ventilation system. It's just slightly different route, I guess, that it takes, whether you need to heat it or cool it. So a well-maintained system with the proper filters, with the right fan moving enough air through the system should be enough, both in the winter and the summer.
Great. And I've been reading a lot about airplanes, for example. So are they worse than buildings, or actually better because of their constant air circulations? Like, even though you're in this really small contained area, is it possibly better because of how much air is circulating?
Well, it's the same, exactly the same thing in the airplanes, actually. I have read a couple of case studies of airplanes that were, I think it was during SARS-1, where they traced back how many people, I don't remember, however many people got infected with one case, because it turns out the filters were not installed. And I think the plane was sitting on the tarmac for a couple of hours without any air conditioning. So again, it depends on the ventilation system. But in general, airplanes have really good ventilation system. Unfortunately, they also pack people very closely together. So there are some sizes of particles that are, and there's two things. There's a huge range of particles, some of them bigger, that can't be removed immediately with the ventilation system. And those particles can, you know, reach another person. And also, there are different routes of exposure, right? You can inhale the aerosols, or you can, you know, just get direct contact from other person that is infected, or you can touch surfaces, and you, like we've been here from the beginning, don't touch your face, don't touch your eyes, don't touch your mouth. So because there's this combination of three different modes that you can get infected, then airplanes might not be the safest places to be, even though they have really good ventilation.
Yeah, no, I hadn't thought about the fact. I guess the whole thing is fewer people is better. And then you're, as we all know, we're packed into those airplanes. I wanted to ask another question. So we sort of have abandoned our offices, right? I mean, they've been empty for, in some cases, 6 months. So when we do start to go back, are there concerns about the buildings being sick in some way? I mean, I've read about Legionnaires' disease. Like, I'm wondering if there are risks associated with now going back to offices after all this time away.
It is possible. I'm not going to say that it's not possible, but I also have to say that some of the essential personnel that have been going to work while we safely work at home have been these maintenance and facilities people. And they, believe me, they have been in most of the places that I know, they have been working overtime to make sure that those ventilation systems that would, you know, if you just shut them down and go away, would be a potential risk of what you mentioned. But in most cases, they are working really hard to make sure that this doesn't happen. Is there still a risk? Yes, I think there's still a risk. But I would like to think that the risk is relatively low. But if you're concerned, if you suspect that the building in your where your office is located has been completely shut down, make sure to contact your administrator, your facilities person, and good cleaning and good maintenance should be enough.
Yeah, another question I have is about schools, because that's all we seem to be talking about lately, right? and I think I know the answer, because really what your message here is a good ventilation system is going to help us with this, and a bad one, it could make us really sick. So schools, I guess, those with a lot of school buildings are old, a lot of the windows don't open, you know, things like that. Are schools a potentially bad place for ventilation problems?
Yes.
Yeah.
I think this is one of the things that we have recognized for a couple of months now, that there's like no easy answer, right? Because staying home and trying to homeschool your kids is just not being productive. You know, you're not getting anything else done.
No.
And I really feel for those, you know, professionals that are now being teachers. I'm trying to be professionals. Like, when do you do it? But also, I'm sure there are some school districts that have really good buildings and really good ventilation. There's been a huge renovation effort in Baltimore City. We have renovated, I don't know, but a good proportion of the schools. But still, that's not the case in the rest of the U.S. Most schools are, like you said, relatively old buildings where I don't think investments have been made recently. So it's on a case-by-case basis, like you say, some schools may be okay, some schools maybe not so much.
Yeah. Is there a way to retrofit in some way? I mean, can you just throw a good HEPA filter onto an old school? I mean, does that do anything?
I don't know if it's that easy.
Yeah.
Because like I was saying, what happens with a HEPA filter is because it's so efficient, it's harder to pull through it. I don't know, people have maybe seen it with their vacuum cleaners. If you have a HEPA filter vacuum cleaner, it just sounds louder. It's just the motor is more potent because it needs to pull through more resistance that is that filter. So not all ventilation systems can be, you know, like retrofitted with a HEPA filter. You can retrofit with the best, you know, filter available, but maybe you need to change the motor and there's maybe going to be a little more expensive than just putting a filter. Having said that, though, we have seen, I don't know if I've seen data on it, but I have seen models. There's a couple of models that have used those portable air purifiers, HEPA air purifiers, which are relatively small, relatively inexpensive units that you can put in a couple of places, and those help move the air and clean the airs, pass them through a HEPA filter. So I think there are some. They're not cheap, but there are some things that can be done. But it's definitely, like you say, not a completely safe environment necessarily. Yeah.
Well, I can't decide if you've made me feel better or worse. I mean, I think the bottom line is, right, a good ventilation system is going to help. At the same time, we can't crowd people in, and older systems just aren't going to be up to the task.
Pretty much.
Anna Rule, thank you so much for joining me.
You're welcome. Thank you very much. And it was a pleasure.
Public Health On Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, Stephanie Desmon, and Lamari Morales. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, Cian Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. thank you for listening.